prompted by what Kevin has said about every house paying £14,000 land value tax. One, the whole purpose of the land value tax is it measures the land value. So therefore, a house in Hampstead or Kensington would not pay the same as a house in the Outer Hebrides or a house in a village in Cornwall. And if we were to collect £14,000 for every house in this country, Kevin's already said there's about 26 million houses, that would collect £364 billion. How much of the land of this country is actually housing land? It's 2%, according to our government. And the other 98% would also contribute an awful lot, places like Oxford Street, middle of Cambridge, sites that are being held out of use in London that pay nothing in taxation today. And of course, with the land value tax bringing more land into productive use, that means more jobs. It means more competition for employees. It means higher wages. It means that we would have fewer people dependent upon the unemployment pay and other social benefits that our taxes are used for. So I would imagine that in a society with a land value tax, we would have much lower government expenditure. Half of our government expenditure today goes either on welfare expenditure or paying dividends to people that have loaned money to the government as regards to government debt. If we had a land value tax, we could have a full, a citizen's land dividend, whereby that would meet your problem about how the government spends the money. If we all shared in the ownership of the land and we all had a land dividend, we ourselves would decide on that element. The Labour Land campaign, together with Tony Benn in 1985, put forward a private member's bill for the common ownership of land. And we said the income from the land rent should be split three ways. One-third to improve public services. One-third to reduce the bad taxes that stop production and create unemployment. And one-third to be redistributed as a land dividend. And the reason we said that in 1985 was because we saw British Gas, British Airways, profitable nationalised industries being privatised by the Thatcher government. Nobody swears about it. Middle class were rushing to the post office to buy their SID shares. But nobody said, well, actually, we're losing. And what we imagined was, by sharing the land dividend, if a Tory government comes along and says, oh, we want to give the land value back to the Duke of Westminster, and people say, well, we're going to lose £2,000 or £3,000 a year. No, thank you. We're not going to vote for that. Do you know where you can look to see such an example? Alaska. In Alaska, they have a permanent oil fund. It's the revenue that arises from the natural resource, the oil in their land. And it's distributed, a proportion of it is distributed every year to every family. Some years, it's as low as $800 a person. Other years, it's as high as $2,000 a person. And it's in statute that that exists. And now, three times, politicians are trying to overthrow it because they don't want the people to have the land dividend, the oil dividend. They want to decide how they'll spend it, whether it be on armaments or other things that hopefully none of us in this room will support. And three times, because it has to be agreed at a referendum, three times the people of Alaska, in their wisdom, have thrown it out and said, we'll keep the dividend. I go around places, internationally and in this country, talking
about land and particularly collecting the rental value of land. I'm president of the International Union for Land Value Tax, and if you want to become a free member, take one of my leaflets and join us. If you want to buy Heather's booklet, Welfare for the Rich, it's only £2 and you're welcome. The original title was going to be Who Subsidises Who? Because it is the poor subsidising the rich. But when I go to schools, I try and explain what economic rent is. It's interesting because most economic teachers in schools all colleges or universities don't bother about economic rent. And that shows in the economic advice that is given to our governments by economists like Mr. Balls and others. But I tell them a little story, and it's based on the Robinson Crusoe town, and with apologies to Daniel Defoe, in my version, Robinson Crusoe swims to the beach, and he's met by Man Friday. And Man Friday says, "Wow, my pleased to see you. I've been here 4 years, and I've been on my own. It's going to be nice to have some company. But I must tell you, I've been busy while I've been here during the 4 years. I set up a parliament. And as I'm the only resident, I elected myself an MP. And as I was the only MP, I elected myself Prime Minister and Chancellor of the Exchequer. And we passed a law that I own all of this island. And we created a police force, and I'm Chief Commissioner of Police. And we create a legal system, and I'm the chief judge. And every morning, I go out into my forest, and with my bare hands, I hunt for rabbits. And after 4 hours, I get one rabbit. I come home, I cook it, it suffices me 24 hours, and the next morning I go out again. You, Robinson Crusoe, you're welcome to stay on my island. But you'll have to go out hunting. I'll give you permission to go hunting in my forest, but you'll have to go out for 8 hours and come home with two rabbits. You give me one and you keep one." Well, poor old Robinson Crusoe says, "This ain't very fair. I'm doing all the work. You're going to lounge on the beach, sunbathing, swimming." So Man Friday says, "Well, we have no slaves on the island. Everybody's a free person. And you're at total liberty to reject my terms. But of course, if you do, you go back to your boat." Of course, it's at the bottom of the locker. He stays. 3 months every day, 8 hours, two rabbits, one each. The end of 3 months, he thinks he's cooking his rabbit on the fire. He thinks, "I can do better than this. I can create capital." Now, capital is person-made wealth being used to produce more wealth. So the next day, out he goes into the forest, and he doesn't do any hunting. He looks for a very sharp flint stone, and after some hours, he finds one. And then he looks for a very straight branch in a tree, and again after some hours he finds one, hacks it down with the stone, strips it of the leaves and the twigs, puts a point at one end, some goose feathers at the other end, and he's proud he now got some capital. The next morning out he goes into the forest with his spear. And after 8 hours he comes home with a number of rabbits. Normally I ask the kids in the class, "How many rabbits has he now got?" And they say, "Perhaps 19 rabbits." And I say, "Well, that's great." He gives one to Man Friday, and with a grin from ear to ear, he's got a path of 18 rabbits in front of him. And Man Friday says, "Wow, Robinson Crusoe, you're a clever bloke. I've been here 4 years and 3 months. I never thought of creating capital. But I've got some bad news for you. Your rent has just gone up to 18 rabbits." And that is the society we live in. And if you want to raise taxes, do you raise taxes on the one rabbit that's left with Robinson Crusoe, or on the 18 rabbits that Man Friday enjoys?